Let me start with my presentation. We always work on the principles of creating meaning and celebrating context. And what do we really mean by creating meaning? You know, for us, it's just not as architects we want to create a meaning for. It's for all the stakeholders who are involved in the process of design. So, you know, whether it's the region or the artisans or the consultants or the contractors, it's like creating meaning for all the stakeholders involved. And our process is very process-based, is very evolutionary. It's very inclusive. We would like to involve everyone who's, you know, part of the project and make it happen. That's the largely the founding principle which we work on. And, you know, we learn every day. And that's what drives us and informs our process. Again, it's a very cliched question, what is sustainability? And I have put this because actually when I started thinking about the facade design, I realized that, you know, it's an important thing to understand and deliberate upon. So what is sustainability? Actually, it should be more than what is sustainable for a country such as ours, because our question needs to be very direct and more imposing and you know, as a value-based question. And in India, you know, we have about 11 climatic zones, and I think we have about, if I'm correct, about 55 soil types. So it's a very diverse geography and diverse climatic zones which we work upon. You know, influences from a north to south, you know, clearly change. And on top of it, you know, as a nation, we need to talk about regions, we need to talk about food, culture, clothing, climate becomes so important, which drives, you know, all the founding principles, I would say. But still, you know, as a country, we still like to look westwards. You know, I've come across examples in our projects where, you know, people like government has in fact asked to, you know, create something like a glass box building, which, you know, we see too much in Gurgaon. And then on top of it, when we do that, then we are in the state of thermal shock, I would say. You know, we add on temperature, you know, we are fighting against heat and cold, and then by doing glass box building, we're just creating a thermal shock. So if not westwards, then where would we look? And I think it's time we need to look inwards perhaps and find a solution. And some of our projects talks about that, I would say. So yes, context is decisive, and we celebrate the context. So it's whether it is the physical planning of the project, and I would say now to think about the exterior expression of the project and so-called the facade design of the project, it is clearly celebrating the context, I would say. And when this you know, subject was thrown open, I initially thought, what will I talk about? But when I started collating the data, actually realized there's a lot to talk about. So I have a lot of projects built in. I don't know whether the time would allow so to cover everything, but I'll try to squeeze through as quickly as possible. But I feel as a narrative, facade design or the exterior expression of the building is a storytelling device. You know, can we look at innovation, which is frugal, when we are looking specifically in facade? You know, can we do with less than more? These are all, this like the framework which we applied projects and to our results. You know, can we be low tech instead of being high tech? How can we cost effective? Because, you know, as a component, the facade can be a pretty expensive component. Can we be cost effective over there? Use of materials, local materials, what are available close by becomes a very important framework. Timelessness is again pretty important. You know, how can we design buildings which can endure and last well? Yes, we can use materials which are available now, but how can it be timeless? How can it last well? It's a very climatic response to our regions is another imposing question which informs and guides, you know, how the building shape up. And it's always a constant dialogue. Even Smaran mentioned, it's a constant dialogue between inside to outside, which creates that. And to every project, creates, you know, the distinction to the so-called R facades to our projects. But contemporizing craft is again a very important aspect where how do we celebrate this heritage, you know, our craftsmen, you know, how can we work more closely with them? How can we reinterpret these skills and materials which are available to us, which are appropriate in today's time? You know, it's authentic to the place, authentic to the people. It's almost like traditional aspects, but how can we make it relevant to now, and how can we celebrate the richness which we have in our culture, with our people, with our craft, with our tools, with our, you know, all the traditional aspects which we work for. And we'll quickly go through a little about us. We are based in New Delhi. We are about 50 people. We are doing multidisciplinary work, as mentioned earlier. So very quickly, touching upon very quick projects. This is a house done in Delhi. As the master plan shows, the project is a tiny component of this plan, where it's in a very dense urban neighborhood, dense, you know, residential colony of Delhi. The landscape is very cacophonic. It's all cluttered. It's, you know, you see the backside of the buildings, and there is no rhythm and rigor. It's almost nothing to really look out. And if the client is looking at creating privacy and probably an urban, you know, kind of an oasis between this clutter. So how can the facade become a tool to create that sense, to connect with the sky, with the nature, with the outside, to create a sense of transparency? And when we created the section, the middle part being, you know, a typical G+4 structure, it has to have four floors because they have their needs. But how can we create a veil, a screen around, like a parda around the facade, which is shown on the outer side, which can create the relationship to the sky and to the trees, and probably can cut the views which we really don't want, you know, the owners to have to the outside, which are not really the best views. So that's how the facade came up. It became a skin which got plonked around the structure, framing views different. In fact, the facade came up pretty much late at the site. Like, we didn't really have a clear direction on the facade in the beginning. So, you know, for the wildest of the time, the client was asking what really is a facade. And I think one distinction we made, we really don't ever work with a very clear facade in the building. You know, typically there is always a thing, okay, you create the building and you show us a 3D view. We kind of not able to show that. We tell them that the facade will evolve, how the inside outside will, how the building will shape up, how the different parameters will shape up. And this is a typical example where actually on the side we were able to create these frames by going floor by floor. You know, we could tinkle around with the opening to be given, whether it's a toilet or it's a room, whether I want to see the other building, other house or not, whether I want to see the sky. It all kept on shaping up while the building was in construction. You know, on the left, you can see the kind of views available. And in those areas, we put the staircase, because the staircase is still a place where you need to just go up and down. And that's where we were able to even inform the spatial planning of the project. You can see again very clearly, this is made out of brick, adding to the thermal mass. But how these frames and how these moments came up, the experiences came up, was trying to look at, you know, what are the better views we can frame. Almost like a veil. This is in Mumbai, which again, I thought it's an interesting project to talk about, where we got the structure, you know, part of the industrial heritage of Godrej Vikhroli. You know, it's a development full of old industrial buildings. And instead of demolishing the building, we kind of did an adaptive reuse. It's an experience center for Godrej real estate development called The Trees. This is the real. This is the experience center, and this is how we found the site, and this is how we interpreted it. Where we kept the concrete frame and added cotton steel as the storytelling device, as the narrative. You know, it's almost like cotton steel is a material which bleeds, which changes over a period of time, over different seasons. So it's almost like creating to the sense of legacy and the previous and the past of the site, you know, the use of this material. So it became a very industrial palette between concrete and cotton steel. These are the elevations of the final project, and how we can use cotton steel louvers to cut the sun and yet allow daylighting in, and how dappled light can become like an important factor, where you can cut the sun and still bring in filtered light to have discussions inside the experience center. That's how it looks at night. Yeah, again, a commercial project, thought interesting to show again on a very dense ring road of Delhi, where it's full of chaos and sound. Again, how, you know, we tried to play it with origami and a metal skin, but how we can cut the sound through using the facade. And yet how we can not allow the views onto the road, because there are probably no views. But how we can play with the perforations and the character of this aluminium sheet. and it can bring in a sense of privacy and buffering that outside sound and the outside views, which really were not really required. I think, again, a work in progress in Gujarat for the Godrej developers, where, again, we were trying to capture the rich past and the mansion feels of the Ahmedabad culture, and how we can interpret the facade in a very rich, iconic way, where they wanted it to be a development where precast concrete can be played with a rich material like champagne bronze inside. And how that as a module of a precast arch, how that a module of a precast concrete arch can become the facade of the building. That's again just completing Royal Enfield headquarters in Chennai, where we were meant to. I'm just showing you the particular part of that project where we were to deliberate upon the south face of the project, and we wanted to bring in an element of the region into it. So the whole south face was meant to be a veranda where you can actually step out, sit, you know, go from one office to the other, but a mix of green and a skin which can perforate, which can breathe, but yet cut the harsh sun of the Chennai south and bring in the cool evening breeze into the project. That's how it shaped up. It's a metal building where it has got inserts of solid areas. It's almost like a module. It's like a grid, like a framework where there is green and the local tile. The local tile became a metaphor of creating this long. It's almost like a 100 meter long corridor, where the local tile became an element to cross by, and it opens up to allow some views and the fresh air to come inside. These are just shots taken. The professional shots are still pending. That's one of the critical project where we explored a boutique luxury hotel in Ras, Jodhpur. Where again, it's the views of the commanding views of the Mehrangarh Fort, which you have it, and the site is nestled, a very small site in the old city of Jodhpur. And this is how we found the site. You know, the framing the views to the Mehrangarh Fort was extremely critical, but it also faced the west face. And in northern India, the west face typically is the harshest face, where the setting sun and the very harsh sun comes in. But there was no option but to have the rooms, being a hotel property, to face the Mehrangarh Fort, the west face. This is how we found the site. We did an adaptive reuse of the existing buildings over a period of time. But again, sectionally, we wanted the views to the fort, but how, like, we can create a veil, a skin, which can allow you those views and yet cut the harsh sun. We looked at Hawa Mahal in Jaipur, which offered us an opportunity that how we can make a perforating, breathing facade. So that is how it shaped it. It was made out of local stone. So we didn't want to get into materials which were being brought far away. This is the material is available about 30, 50 kilometers. Local craftsmen created this look. So again, a play of shadow and light, all the corridors, in fact, became non-air conditioned. You know, for a boutique property, an expensive property, non-air conditioned corridors, you know, the tourists really loved it. The guests really loved it because the solid stone is giving you that buffer, and how, you know, the skin which can open up towards the evening. So when you have to have the views at night, how the stone skin can open up and kind of breathe through. So it's always an evolving facade. Whichever room stone jali opens up, you know, you get it kind of changes over a period of time. That's how it looks, like a lantern at night. And that's how you get the quality of light and shadow, you know, during the day in the veranda. These are some more views of the relationship of the inside and the outside. And that's a quick video to show, we were trying to engineer it, and we worked with all expensive German fittings to create this movable skin. But actually, we had to engineer it ourselves. This is almost 400 kilos of solid stone, 400 kgs of solid stone, which can close, you know, whenever you want to. And it's still working, pretty well, even now. Krishi Bhavan again a very interesting project, the first government project for us, where we were inside Bhubaneswar, and the client's brief was to create a dialogue between the farmers and the officials, the government officials, but we added a layer to involve the citizens into it, making it a public place. So instead of making a solid building, we perforated the ground floor to create the connection to the city. And again, in any the for us the environmental aspects, if I can highlight, we wanted materials which age gracefully, which are low maintenance, which are very robust. The facade need to be very robust, easy to maintain, you know, over 20, 30 years of its span. How can we still get 100% daylighting into it, and still how, by being very cost effective, being very on the project cost, how we can still make the project very iconic, and how again local traditions and local craftsmen can, you know, work at an architectural level. So the ground floor podium was thought of it as a heart. These are some details of how we evolved the section, where we created a kind of a night purge system, where we were trying to bring in the cool air at night, store it inside, and then dissipate it during the day through mechanical louvers on the south side. So it was devised as a double skin structure, as you can see. So there are, we did daylighting studies. There are windows which are fixed windows, in fact, which are getting the daylight. And the second skin, which is very typical of any traditional Indian architecture, the second skin allows the light to come in and yet cuts the heat outside. And then to add a layer of creating it iconic and a regional influence, we worked, this is a simple brick facade, a brick jali. We used four colors of brick. And we reinterpreted that facade into an ikat pattern, which is a very typical Odisha weaving pattern. We did a lot of prototyping in the beginning. So how that local pattern can actually become, you know, the window to the building, to the, you know, creating the character to the building. These are some detailed shots of that double skin structure. That's how, you know, all local materials, brick was still brought in, but the local condolite and the local laterite, you know, was taken, the plinth, the ground floor plinth was made by that. And the above three floors were this skin structure, which had an ikat like form. Some more details, you know, we involved about 100 craftsmen for about 6 months to create their livelihood, and their work was actually manifested at the architectural level. You know, at not just series of small artworks and all, but an architectural level, the whole building is graced by mythological stories of Ramayana, Patichatra. You know, all the local kind of stories were weaved into the building. As you can see, that's how you know, the entrance shot of the building. That's the inner courtyard. These are some details of the inner courtyard. Some more details of the facade, and that's how it looks at night. That's again, I don't know if the time allows, I'll quickly take them through a small video. So you can see the ground plane.
We were quite excited, you know, with the quantum of work that could be generated if artisans, you know, if craft and architecture could come together. And I think that has been a big achievement, that this building project could generate work for about 50 artisans for a continuous 6 months. And
sorry, 50
we
artisans.
Actually got, you know, artisans who had stopped working in the traditional skills. We convinced them to come back and to start working again.
चिंताधाराटा से गोटे भितर रही निर्दिष्ट मूर्ति बनवे चिंताधाराटा से भर सीमित था जहा फल यही कम कृषि भवन कम करने को देखा गला प्रकृत आम कलाटा को केमती का अन्य दृष्टि भी देखिपर
This is dhokra work, you know, the beaten metal work.
We could bring in artisans and craft. If you talk of farmers and if you talk about, you know, people coming from villages to this building, then you want to show them something that's familiar to their environment. And that is where craft comes in.
Yeah, is there more time or? Max House. So that's a commercial project again in Delhi opposite Bahai Mandir. And this is the overall master plan of three building blocks. We have done the first block for now. And I'll skip through the evolutionary process. But what we were again looking at is, like, while looking at the massing of the building, the whole ground floor level was the public level with podium parking. And from where we are able to get better views, because on the right hand side there was an old railway colony, so we didn't want to allow those views. So that becomes a solid block at the bottom level, and the upper level where the floors are being leased out, you get far better views of Bahai Mandir in Kalkaji area of New Delhi. So these were the initial sections and how we wanted the facade to behave. And then again, in this, again, very important, and the only thing I want to highlight is that we actually do a lot of studies with our energy consultant when it comes to, passive cooling techniques and even facade planning techniques. Here we made it a point that we should have a, specific 60-40 wall window ratio, because facade planning can ensure that you have good quality energy parameters inside. You can save on your AC cost, you can save on your running cost. So this particular project is an example that how a clever planning of facade, there is no need in a commercial space. There's always this thing to give green, like vast glass boxes. But again, we have done this project and completed where we found that actually, even if you use the technique of a wall window ratio, you can get enough daylighting in and yet still create an iconic character of it. So again, we could pick up some architectural elements of the neighborhood. It belongs to Modi estate, where the old warehouses were done in brick and they had some kind of a rhythmic colonnade pattern in it. So we picked up that pattern. We in fact created the section of the building keeping in mind that it should not go beyond 16 to 18 meters very early on, because in our daylight studies we could see that if we keep that depth of the footplate, then we can get enough daylighting towards the outer sides, and the inner side, the middle side, can even become cabins, or they can become a corridor as a section. These were further detailing which was done while looking at the section of the building where the falsy levels and the HVUC units were plonged in to create actually the wall window ratio. These are the initial renders where it's made out of brick. That's the ground floor podium, and these are the levels on top, where a rhythm, a very simple rhythm of glass and and refuge areas were given, and that's how it sits at this point of time. That's the completed project. Just skipping through all this, and maybe the last video looking at the facade, looking at the context of the building in relation to the region and then to the neighborhood. So that's the section I was talking about, that the kind of section developed, it gives you enough light, in an open space planning, even if you have a wall window ratio. Yes, I think that's the I can probably quickly talk about a last project. It's in the hills where our brief was to create a luxurious monastery. We looked at the regional influences around how the houses have been made. We created a section looking at the north mountain views and getting the south sun in. Again, that became a framework to create the facade of the building. These were initial studies. What we did particularly in this project was to really map out what are the local stones you're getting. In fact, we did an extensive study of what is the expensive stone and what is the cheaper stone, so that when we start working on the facade, we are able to maximize the cheaper stone on larger areas and get the expensive stone on the in a smaller proportion. That's the craftsman working on the facade of the building. That's how finally the facade shaped up, you know, the expression of the building with wood and stone in it. These are the early views. You know, that's a very rhythmic monastic feel of the facade which we were able to create, and that's how, you know, this project sits against the you know, the hills. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much, Architect Siddharth. It was absolutely amazing to see such wonderful works. And like very rightly you mentioned that it's got to do with the culture that in which city are you sort of building something, and the last project was absolutely sort of matching to that. So thank you very much. We have a question for you, and the question says, it's by Mr. Biraj Jain, and he's asking, what are the contemporary sustainable materials you would recommend that can be used? Could you share your thoughts, please?
I guess depending on the region and depending on where you are placed, you know, our obvious choice becomes whatever is locally available, you know, within a certain distance and a radius. So, you know, it could be north, we end up using a lot of brick. We can end up, you know, using, in fact, in certain projects now we have started using bamboo as well. But you know, brick, stone, I guess these are the materials, like avoid as much glass, you know, avoid. So the idea is to push the glass back and create probably a second skin. So I would say brick, stone, these are the kind of materials which can easily be used. We are doing projects now which has got a mix of bamboo and green in it also, you know, a mix of materials, I would say.
All right, thank you so much, and I hope we enjoyed too much. I hope you also did. So thank you, and we will see you soon. Thank you for doing this.
Thank you.
Please take care.